Mr. Palunas?
Here.
Mr. Russo?
Here.
Mr. Zellwin?
Here.
Okay, we need the approval of the minutes of December 11th.
I move to approve the meetings from the Safety and Public Properties meeting of December 11th, 2019.
Second.
We have a motion, a second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, brings us to reports. Jail report. Chief, anything you want to bring to the committee's attention?
Nothing of note to report this month.
Okay, any questions from the committee?
Nope.
Okie doke. Brings us to police and fire. Item number two, a memo from Police Chief Tinelli concerning traffic logics. Chief?
Yes, back in on December 11th, when we had the Safety and Public Properties meeting, we were discussing possibilities, how to curtail some of the speeders in the residential districts, and I brought up the fact that in Glen Willow they have a traffic, or the radar speed sign that actually I think aids to people adhering to the speed. I indicated to you guys that I was going to do a little study, and I got information from Traffic Logic for their Safe Pace Evolution 12-inch radar speed sign. I think you guys have those documents.
Right.
So it listed, if you got to look over it, it listed the amounts. I think it was $2,724 per unit. That included shipping and handling. I know we discussed maybe getting three of them, which would be a total of $8,172. There is in this documentation information on the features of the unit. I guess the one thing I want to caution or bring to your attention again is, like all the other, when we get a complaint of a speeders in a residential district, we do different forms of maybe a speed trailer, maybe we do selective enforcement where the police car and the police officer is, you know, on the street for a length of time, and we seem to curb the speed during those times. This is a mobile unit that has a bracket that you can easily attach and detach. I know we can't put one on every residential street. If you put it up for a week to a month, I'm pretty confident that it would slow down some of the motorists, but I can't guarantee, obviously, that after you moved it, that we wouldn't have the same complaints again, but it would be something to show that we're doing something.
Right. And again, I think that would be up to the officer that's in charge of selective enforcement to determine which form of selective enforcement to use where there are complaints. So
yeah.
That'd be great. Any questions from the committee? Okay, I'll entertain a motion.
I make a motion that the legislation be prepared to purchase three Traffic Logic Safe Space Evolution 12 signs in the amount of $8,172.
Second.
We have a motion, a second. Just one quick question. Would there be any need to do this under emergency, or this is something? Okay, just want to make sure. All right, so we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, item 2A, we have a memo from Police Chief Tinelli concerning the K-9 unit. Chief?
Yep. So the police department will be replacing our retired K-9 unit in 2020. And as a result, we did a comprehensive search to determine which dog training company that we could contract with in regards to what would serve our needs the best, and also which would be financially responsible for the city. I think you guys have those documents as well.
Correct.
At the conclusion of our research, we determined that Shallow Creek Kennels in Sharpsville, PA best met our needs, both for what we wanted and needed and for the price. And that price was $14,300. I do have to note in the documentation, which includes the three quotes, it is $25 more than the lowest quote. And I think the reason that is because that second quote, that's $25 less, they don't provide a kennel, which is at least $100. And the reputation of that that company is not as documented as the Shallow Creek company.
Any questions from the committee? I do have one question. Would you want this under emergency? It seemed like you needed to have this by...
Yeah, so basically, being in correspondence with Shallow Creek, we want to get the dog picked out. So they have different dates in this year. We'd like to be able to start this process by February 3rd. Mm-hmm. In order to do that, we need a contract, and then they need a $10,000 check written to them, or PO, mm-hmm. by that date, and they will hold that spot for February 3rd. If not, we're not going to get the dog for 7 or 8 months okay. further down the year.
All right, so any motion would need to be under emergency. So I'll entertain that motion.
I'll move to have legislation prepared under emergency for the reason that the length of time is going to be urgent to receive this canine animal. And this is with recommendation of the police chief as the lowest and best bid, as they were not the lowest, and incorporate the police chief's notes that the kennel is included and that would equalize the bets. The amounts. Yeah. Thank you.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, brings us to traffic enforcement. The traffic report for December, Chief Tinelli. Anything?
Thank you, Mr. Russo. A select enforcement was conducted on Arbordale and Brooklyn Avenue at the request of Mr. Russo. This was based on concerns of the residents due to construction in the area. The times focused on were the beginning of the school day and the end of the school day. The patrol division directed 12 hours of patrol time in this area, resulting in the issuance of one citation for speeding and 4 warnings for speed.
Okay, great. Thank you. Any other issues or questions on selective enforcement? Okay, brings us to Public Works, item number 3. Let's see, lease agreement from Mr. Dursick. Mr. Dursick.
Before you, you have a memo with a signed lease agreement that was negotiated between the administration of the City of Solon and the Solon Historical Society Board. The Finance Department, Law Department, Public Works Division all were part of the negotiation. Part of the lease would include that the Historical Society placed $300,000 into escrow to fund the construction costs, and then if there's additional costs needed, they would have to add to that escrow fund. There's also a $10,000 fund that they would have to put money into for ongoing maintenance, since this is a city-owned property. Also part of the lease agreement is they would have to follow our RFQ process to find which is a quality-based selection process for a architect and an engineer to perform the design to go out to bid for this project. Also, in my memo here, it states that for any reason, should the Historical Society back out of the lease or not abide by the lease agreement, the City of Solon will have the house raised within 30 days. And also, they have to put the $300,000 into the escrow account with Mr. Rubino within 15 days of the ordinance going into law. So I'm requesting that the committee prepare legislation for the mayor to enter an agreement with a lease agreement with the Historical Society for the property at 34025 Bainbridge Road, and also under emergency so we can move forward to get it moving before, so we can get it somewhat simultaneously with the 2020 bicentennial.
Any questions from the committee? Jeremy?
So I've got a couple questions and comments. So Bill, along with the going through the RFQ process for the vendors on the engineering side and the architecture side, will they have to go through those same processes to get the work done?
No, the work would just go out once the RFQ is done and we pick the architect and the engineer to do the design. The bid documents would be prepared by that firm, and then we would go through our normal bidding process to put the project out for construction.
And anyone doing the construction work would be licensed contractors, all up to city spec and all that?
Yes. The complete city process, no different than a roof or anything else that the city does. Inspections, the whole.
You can go to Bob and then I'll go back.
Okay, Bob.
I have just one question for Mr. Lobey. Under this agreement, the city is not... the city is not going to be spending any money out of our own coffers for the construction, remodeling, or anything else. Is that correct?
That is correct. In fact, it's a replenishing agreement that after they put in certain amounts... That is correct. In fact, the agreement is a replenishing agreement where basically after they get to a certain level, they have to replenish it. It includes a wide variety of including but not limited to clauses that you're probably familiar with, including all the construction costs, advertising costs, any other costs associated. We tried to include everything, and that was a hard negotiation with Historical, but we placed that financial burden on them and them only.
Yeah.
Jeremy?
So, you know, I've talked to Mr. Kovacek's here tonight from the Historical Society, so I've spoken with him prior to tonight's meeting, right, and let him know where I stand, and I just want to make my point on the record here. So I don't support the city putting any of our money into this project, right? But at the same time, if the Historical Society wants to fund the project and do the project with their own money up to the city standards, you know, and update it as agreed upon with the city, I'm fine with it. I think the one thing that I don't want to see happen is I don't want to see this house become a money pit for the Historical Society where that impacts their ongoing duty to, you know, monitor or to maintain the current Historical Society. And Mr. Kovacek and I spoke through this, and, you know, he's I think, not to speak for you, Ken, but in agreement with what I'm saying, right? Where after the engineering study and after the bids go out and come back, I think Historical Society is going to say, okay, is this a $50,000 project or is this a $1 million project? Just to throw out a crazy number, it's probably not a $1 million project, right? So, and I think that there's going to be a decision point at that point if this where the Historical Society wants to go, right? So I'm fine as long as the city doesn't put a penny into the project, right? And I don't want it to get to a place where the Historical Society puts hundreds of thousands of dollars and then comes back to the city and says, hey, we need you to bail us out, because I'm not going to support that bailout.
That was the point. I thank you for saying that, because that was the point of what I was saying when I was asking Mr. Lobey, because I just don't want the taxpayers to be funding this rehabilitation, remodeling, and everything else. This is solely on behalf of the Historical Society. The city's not paying for it. Everything's in the lease agreement. We have all the abilities to go forward if there is a problem, if they would be an issue of non-payment, which I don't foresee here, but there's everything's in the lease agreement. So I'm comfortable. The whole burden is on the Historical Society to make the payments and to follow through and do everything. So if they don't, the city would then get possession of the property and we would be able to issue the requisite notices and everything else, and we would not be out any money.
Mr. Lobey, I take it you want to say something.
In addition to the $300,000, there's also a secondary fund for the maintenance thereafter also, just so you know. It was discussed with the Historical Society representatives that we would also have an RFQ, and we have been developing one. I believe it's part of your package.
I didn't hand it out.
You didn't include it with it? Okay. That we are even going out, and it's quite a... detailed package that has been reviewed not only by the administration, Public Works, Engineering, Planning, and myself, that will get to the historical significance. The city is the only one that makes a decision on this. We will have input from the Historical Society. We have promised them at least input that they will be at the table, but the final and the only decisions will be in the sole discretion of the city and the city only, even though they will be at the table. And we have a significant input as to keeping the integrity to make it a historical building. And there was discussion that if it comes back and that it's going to be too much, depending upon how the plans come out, that they would then ask the city to get out of the project and withdraw the money and terminate it after the RFQ comes in. Those were discussions we had with the board.
That's not in the lease agreement, though.
No, it was understood that that they would have the right to terminate it at that time. And we could include that, we can include a clause to that effect. This was at the last meeting that we had with representatives and the administration and the mayor of the planning department with them.
Right. Mr. Palunas.
Would there be a time frame for the RFQs? Would there be a time frame so the house isn't just sitting there?
There's a schedule within the RFQ. I can hand these out to you if you'd like to see them.
I thought you had it. I apologize. And we've been working on the RFQ knowing that you'd be asking these questions.
Now, within the RFQ, obviously, these are tentative dates because everything is going to be dependent on when things pass through committee and council.
Mr. Palunas?
Tom, would all money be refunded if we didn't go forward with it, or if some money was expended, how would that work?
And we should probably
microphone.
This should all be in here, Tom.
Yeah, we discussed this after it was agreed to that we wanted to get to this particular matter, that if they decided to withdraw from it, that we would add up all the expenses, and if there was any balance left, that they would then, after all the expenses that the city incurred, and it'll probably take us 30 to 60 days to gather those in, and if the board decided that the RFQ and the proposal seems to be too much, that they would then withdraw it and ask for termination of the lease.
Okay, thank
okay?
you.
And the net profits would go back. And again, all the monies will be under the sole control. In fact, one of the other negotiated things is they want a joint control of the checking account, and we stood firm on that particular thing, that we have singular and sole control of even the checking account. But it probably could have been in there, Bob, you're correct, but we just wanted to get it to this point.
Any other questions? Okay, well, I'm gonna apologize to people ahead of time because I know this will pass, but I'm not in favor of it. Mr. Schmitz did ask me the other night after the council meeting how I was gonna vote. I already let him know. First of all, I'd just like to get a little background so everyone has an understanding of what has happened over the years. And I'd like Mr. Franklin first to give some history on the master plan and also the solicitation of input from the Historical Society about the Lynch home and the Bull home.
Sure, I have a quick some notes here. The Lynch home was purchased in 2005, and it was purchased primarily at that time because we had just purchased earlier the Solon Bowl home. So there was a gap in ownership between the Historic Society and the Solon Bowl home, and then this property came up for sale. So the city purchased it in 2005. There was no purpose to the purchase at that time, no identified purpose. There was a lot of discussion between 2005 and 2010 of various uses for the property, that it could be an entertainment area, that it could be an annex for the Historic Society, that it could be an annex for the Art Center, and of course that it could be a fallback for fire station number 2, which it actually ended up being. So that between 2005 and 2010, those were the discussions that I can find in my notes on it. In 2010, the city adopted its first master plan. And at that time, the recommendation within the master plan was that there would be an outdoor entertainment area there, and that the structure would be removed. The plan was readopted in 2016, and the same recommendation came through. So what's in the master plan right now, just for historical purposes here, is I'll put it up on the screen.
Sir, so
basically, this is, this, oh, if we pull out a little bit. A lot? Okay, I guess not. So this is the area we're talking about right here. This is the Solon Bowl home, which is identified as a museum that would be utilized by the Historic Society. It actually is not the way that the plan is worked out. The Historic Society itself, and also remember as part of this, fire station number 2 had not been constructed yet, but it is constructed according to this plan. Veterans Memorial Park was done according to this plan. And then the final piece was the outdoor entertainment area, which was shown in the area that you see on the map. So that's what's in the master plan right now.
Right. And during the preparation of the master plan and the update to the master plan, were people from the Historical Society consulted as far as to get their input as far as the use of those?
There were discussions during the development of the plan, primarily focusing on the Solon Bowl home and whether that would be a museum or not and the level of interest in it. Initially, as I recall, there was an interest in it, and that's the way that it was written into the master plan. But I don't recall at that time being much discussion about the Lynch home then.
But yeah, so in at no time was there any interest expressed in this home?
I think it simply was floated as a possible use because we'd bought it. We didn't know what the use was.
As far as the Historical Society's use.
Yeah, I mean, I think that idea was floated, but I don't know that it was ever discussed with any interest or in any detail.
Okay. And then everyone received the letter from the Director of Economic Development?
Yes.
That was sent out today. Tom? Council and the mayor take an oath of office. What is included in that oath of office?
Excuse me, I couldn't hear the question.
Okay, when we take the oath of office, what are we supposed to be swearing to? What are we going to protect?
It's the U.S. Constitution, the Charter, and the ordinances of the City of Solon.
Okay.
State of Ohio. Thank you, Robert.
And is there something in the Charter that
yes, there is.
I requires think us to use the master plan?
There is. I don't know if you have it.
It's in their packet.
I think it's your last page of your packet. We highlighted it for you. It's in the Charter, Section 10D, 10E, excuse me, Master Plan Review by City Council. Basically, it starts off within 3 months of the receipt of the proposal to approve, deny, or modify the City of Solon Master Plan from the Planning Commission, because it goes from the Commission to the Planning Commission, then to City Council. City Council shall review and consider those recommendations and shall either approve and adopt the master plan recommendations or approve or some modification thereof. The last sentence is the one that I think that you are referring to, and it reads in the Charter, after the master plan has been approved by City Council, the Planning Commission and City Council shall consult with the master plan and adhere to the recommendations to the extent reasonable and practical in performing their duties and exercising their powers. Okay. I take it that's the portion right of the Charter that you were looking for.
Right. Okay. And again, I apologize because this is hearsay, and I just want to get these items cleared up. At any time since May through this process, did you address conflict of interest or ethic violations with anybody concerned with drafting this lease?
I did.
And how many times did you mention that?
Numerous times and also in writing.
Okay, and yet we still went forward with drafting this lease.
We did, but it was also with that individual, but also with other representatives of the Historical Society. That's correct.
I think it's highly unusual that we would do something like this.
That's why I gave the advice I gave. I give a lot of advice. A lot of people don't follow it, but I give advice.
Okay. I guess the other thing I've got a question on is that, and Bob, you can help me with this one, because I was told by a board member of the Historical Society that Bob Schimmett said that you were helping them with the lease. negotiate the lease.
I have had no conversations, Mr. Lobey. Is that correct?
Zero with me, Bob.
I've had no conversations with them. I've had no conversations. I was never retained by anyone and never...
Okay, just like I said, I just wanted to make sure because, again, the board member from the Historical Society told me that's what they were told by Bob. Okay. So I guess what I need to know is, do conflicts of interest matter? Or we just go ahead and it's the wild, wild west, we can do whatever the hell we want?
Conflicts of interest absolutely matter. I felt that there was a conflict. I think I did my job, I did my duty, and I followed it up even in writing.
Okay.
And my memo also included various opinions mm-hmm. that I thought were more than relevant and practically spot on point.
Okay, thank you. All right, next thing, in May, the administration asked Mr. Dursick to bring to the Safety Committee authorization to raise the Lynch home. Safety Committee did give that authorization, even though it wasn't needed because that amount was under the administration's authority. So I guess the question is, why are we back here with a lease when permission was given to the administration to raise the Lynch home? Mayor?
To that. I mean, it was always my intention to negotiate a lease. If it was paid for by the Historical Society and if the city had control over the process.
Okay, so if your intention was to negotiate a lease, why did you send Mr. Dursick to the Safety Committee to raise the lease?
We didn't have any information at the time that the Historical Society was going to pay for it. Those are my two conditions. One is that was going to be, I made it perfectly clear to everybody, no city money and city control over the whole process.
Okay. Well, we weren't given that information that you were looking for that. And I guess the next question is, do you agree with a master plan or not?
Absolutely.
And I mean, how does this fit in with the master plan?
What did we do to the Sears site? Do we follow the master plan?
Mm-hmm. I want to know how this adheres to the master
completely plan. Completely adheres to the master plan. Having the historical site with the homes there and with the opportunity to make it various things that we can do there, it completely adheres to the master plan. As you know, it's not a law. It's just a guide.
I know it's a guide, but...
Just like we did with the Sears site. We had a master plan,
mm-hmm.
and we didn't follow it.
Right.
Just like we've done a dozen other times. It's a guide. And you have to do what's reasonable, you know, and practical.
All right.
And there may be opportunities in the future where we're not going to follow it strictly because it's not a law. I mean, you have to do, you know, what's reasonable and practical.
Okay, what's not reasonable and practical in my mind is when you send something to the Safety Committee, knowing that you want to negotiate a plan, I think you should have waited to see that. Mm-hmm. I'm not real happy that this is here a third time. And I am not going to vote no. And I just feel that for several reasons. First and foremost, this is the bicentennial year. And I think the focus should be on putting that bowl home together.
Second, and that's what we're doing.
Right. But again, I've got more here. Second, we're spending another $20 million on infrastructure this year, similar to what we spent last year. We're going to be doing the bowl home. And we want Public Works to be distracted to do the Lynch home. I just don't see that. The other thing is my fear is based on what I've seen transpire over at the Historical Society, I have no confidence at all that Lynch home will be used for nothing more than storage. Those are my concerns. And again, I apologize for everyone for, you know, thinking differently than everybody else here, but like I said, this is the third time this has come up. And I think from what I hear, this is going to be substantially more than $300,000. And I just don't want to see the city held back on trying to get the Bull Home together and the infrastructure projects that need to get done this year.
Mr. Russo, that's not going to happen. I can guarantee you. Mr. Dusek is quite capable of handling all of the projects. He did a phenomenal job last year under some very difficult circumstances in handling $24 million in infrastructure projects, a lot more difficult than what this project's going to be. And I have the utmost confidence in Bill to be able to handle it, deliver it in the AAA plus fashion that he always does, and with the help of the team here as well. So
I have all the confidence as well, but I don't think that we should be distracted with something that really does not help, you know, the majority of residents in Solon.
That area is not a distraction. It's going to be a beautiful area for the community.
Mm-hmm. And you're confident that it's going to be more than a storage holding place?
Yes.
And if it's not?
It's going to be. It's not a question of it's not.
Okay. All right, well, listen, I'll entertain a motion.
I move that legislation be prepared authorizing the mayor to enter into agreement with the Solon Historical Society for a lease located at 34025 Bainbridge Road under emergency.
Second.
Hey, any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
No.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Brings us to engineering, item number four.
Well, the committee has my report before them. I can address any questions you might have.
Any questions from the committee? Okay. Under service department, item number five, the HVAC system upgrade study.
There's no new material. We're working, Tom and I and Mark Hawley are working together to put together a proposal with Johnson Controls to go on a state contract to put this into phases based on the budget amount that Mr. Rubino put in the budget, which I think was roughly $160,000. The main focus of the first phase is going to handle the CO issues that are sometimes causing issues in our locker room down there.
Should we put this on the inactive agenda? Because it's been tabled.
You can remove it. It can be removed. Because we'll come back with either legislation to use Sourcewell or Sourcing Alliance for a contract for the first phase. Okay. So it can be removed from the agenda.
All right. Great. Well, then, is there a motion to remove this item?
I'll move we remove item number five from the agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay. Brings us to the end of our agenda. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Meeting adjourned.
Thank you.